Welcome to the new sound of online radio. Welcome to the sound of Universal Broadcasting Network. A mix of today's hits and hard-to-find favorites, combined with the most entertaining and intriguing talk anywhere. This is your sound. This is the sound of Universal Broadcasting Network at UBNRadio.com.
Well, I guess you got the bonus plan.
Well, everyone, welcome back to Elevate the Conversation. This is episode...
If you had been here before...
Then welcome back. And if you're new...
Then welcome.
Then just welcome.
Just simple welcome.
This is episode...
Let's try to keep it simple tonight, Ron.
Well, it feels complex already, Doc.
Really?
I got to be honest.
Okay.
This is episode number 143.
143, Ron.
Amazing.
Can you imagine how much this has cost somebody?
We thought we're going to do about 10 of these, and we're at 143 already. We're coming to you live from Gower Studios in Hollywood, California. I'm, of course, Captain Ron, my dear partner over here, Dr. Frank.
I'm here.
He's here. Jarvis is here. El Topo's here. And we also have a special guest, not in studio, but he's with us live via Skype.
Whoa. We have another guest who's in studio.
Well, we have two other people here.
Right. We've got
Michael Stein.
Mike Stein holding up the... Jewish
end of the spectrum,
right? And we have
Robbie
Janix, who changed his name just recently. But more
this morning,
this more important than that, we have the great Norm Stamper.
Excellent,
Norm Stamper.
Welcome to the show, Norm.
Hi, Norm.
Good to be with you.
Now, I don't know, Ron, if you're aware of this, but Norm is a big deal.
I am aware of that.
Yeah. Now, Norm, you're up in Seattle. Is that correct?
I am at the moment. I'm visiting a friend in Seattle. I actually live on Orcas Island, which is about 80 miles north by car and 23 by boat to my place.
Oh, is that right? Orcas, now that's killer whale stuff, correct? Or is that orca?
Well, it's interesting. It sounds like it's killer whale stuff, and there are killer whales in the San Juan Islands, but it was actually named for a Spanish explorer.
Ah. Was it Juan?
Well, actually, there is the Strait of Juan de Fuca, and the history gets convoluted.
I thought so. No. We love the history of the passages through the islands in the Northwest Territory. Ron did a dissertation on that.
Right. We study that a lot. We bring that up. But well, today we're going to talk about Norm's history with as a police chief and as a cannabis enthusiast.
First of all, are you a cannabis enthusiast individually, or are you just a cannabis enthusiast in your role as an advocate with law enforcement against prohibition?
I am a very strong believer in individual freedom. I'm a strong believer in research-driven, evidence-based conclusions that lead to public policy.
So logic and reason.
From my point of view, our policy over the decades in this country on cannabis has been wrongheaded, if not pigheaded.
So wait, are you trying to tell me that you're actually going to try to think this through? That you're actually taking life experience and education and formulating a plan that has some basis in logic?
I realize how seditious that sounds.
We don't find a lot of that, Norm.
Well, Norm, it was great having you on the show, Norm, because we're not used to that kind of stuff around here. So anyway, a brief history from my. Now, you were the police chief in Seattle, correct?
I was for 6 years, 1994 to 2000. Before that, I was a San Diego cop in your state from 1966 to 1994. So 34 years in the business.
And then it was just a simple protest with some innocent protesters getting hit with tear gas that changed your mind? Is that what switched you over? It was building to that point.
No, actually, pretty much my entire adult life, and certainly all but maybe 14 months of my police career, has been spent in trying to change an institution that I think is completely out of step with the tenets of a democratic society and with our community needs and community expectations. If you're talking about the WTO, the Battle of Seattle, and I suspect you are.
Yes, I'm insinuating.
The worst mistake of my career was spent during that that week here in Seattle.
Do you mind sharing that week with our audience? Because I'm sure in the Northwest, everyone knows the Battle of Seattle, but down here, we think that's a wrestling event. What is the Battle of Seattle? What happened?
In 1999, late November, early December, roughly 50,000 anti-globalization protesters assembled to engage in a debate, one way to put it, with the World Trade Organization and with the 8,000 WTO ministers who had assembled in our city for the purposes of the WTO ministerial conference. We took the position that we're going to be neutral. We're going to not only permit but encourage open and free dialogue and a conversation about the effects of globalization, not just on the United States economy, but throughout the world. And for about 2 days, that happened.
Right.
And then on the morning of the second day, things went south on us.
What happened?
What happened is we used chemical agents, a euphemism for tear gas, against nonviolent and indeed non-threatening protesters. Fellow Americans gathered to express their opinions about a global issue. And we made a monumental mistake in using tear gas against those who are not violent, not even threatening violence. And I can tell you, dating back to my time in San Diego in the 1960s, a time of anti-war protests and campus unrest, civil rights insurrections, we needed, we believe, to use tear gas as what some would call a force multiplier.
Right.
You're completely outnumbered by demonstrators, and you're in danger of being overrun, broken windows, some violence, this sort of thing, that sort of thing, that the only thing you can really do is declare an unlawful assembly, trot out the tear gas, and apply liberally.
Okay, so now, Norm.
We should have been disabused of the wisdom of that back in the 60s. And putting it bluntly, I forgot that really important historical lesson.
Norm, did you make the call on the tear gas? I mean, was that your call?
By default, my field commander, my operations commander, said, we need to clear this intersection. What if we have somebody bleeding to death two blocks away? What if somebody's giving birth on the 27th floor of the Sheraton? What if somebody is in cardiac arrest in one of those high-rise office complexes? And so the cop in me said, well, of course, we need to be able to get emergency vehicles through this intersection. Well, the fundamental question was, really? Did we really need to do that? Or could we have waited out those demonstrators who had locked arms and taken a seat in the middle of an intersection?
Well, let me ask you, put a question in historical perspective. Just recently, a very, very pro-right, anti-globalization speaker was going up to Berkeley, and he was going to give a speech. The people in Berkeley turned on him, started burning things and going crazy. So he was essentially fighting for the same thing that the anti-globalization people were fighting for. But the people who were anti-non-globalization essentially shut him down, started burning the buildings and breaking the windows in the streets of Berkeley. So where do we stand on that? I mean, is the issue the issue? Or is it more the right of free speech?
You know, I can't say that the issue is the issue. We will always be divided.
Right.
You know, globally and certainly here at home. We will always have pro-forces and anti-forces. Name an issue, we will have pro- and anti-forces rallying around those particular polar extremes. That same speaker, by the way, came to Seattle and spoke at the University of Washington, or at least he tried to.
He was shut down there too?
At which point a man was shot outside of the meeting hall at the University of Washington. So that's more or less closed the entire incident or the event down. I think we need to find a way as Americans to gather, to assemble, to express ourselves freely without fear of violence. And that's a major challenge. I mean, I feel intensely many of the issues that are being expressed these days throughout this country. We need to find a way not only to talk, but to listen. And I think we're
failing. We're failing miserably, Norm. We're failing miserably.
Well put, Doc.
I do not, under any circumstances, and I'll put this out there, I know my wife is going to get mad because she says never get political. I do not, under any circumstances, believe in anything that the person who, the right-wing individual who got shut down at Berkeley has to say. I don't believe in any of his tenets, his philosophies, but I absolutely believe that he has a right to say it. I mean, to shut them down, for as much as it's against what I believe, I think that if we start taking away our ability to say what we want to say, how do we still call ourselves a democracy?
I was a cop for 34 years. The last 17 years in so-called retirement, I have spent writing, observing, speaking about American law enforcement and the desperate, urgent need for institutional reform. So I've been there. I've been on the streets of both San Diego and Seattle during major social upheaval. And I could not agree more with you. One of the fundamental tenets of an American form of democracy, where we value peace and freedom and free expression, is exactly that. The opportunity to say what's on our minds and in our hearts, and particularly where we disagree with the people expressing those views. We've got to find a way to allow for free speech. We must find a way for that to happen. Some of the most onerous statements that I've heard in the American political process have been made in the last year and a half.
Norm, can I turn your attention now for 1 second to the cannabis issue, which is what we focus on this show? You said you've been doing this 34 years as a police officer and 6 years as a police chief. I'd love to hear your opinion over that time span, what your feelings on cannabis are and how it was for a law enforcement viewpoint.
And whether they've evolved or whether you've always felt the same way.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
They have certainly evolved, but my evolutionary process represents ancient history. I became a cop on the streets of San Diego in 1966. At that time in the state of California and every other state in the country, the mere possession as an adult of a seed or a stem of a cannabis plant was a felony. And so my fellow officers and I were about the business, among our many other duties and responsibilities, of arresting people, typically young people, in possession of small quantities of marijuana. Is there anything more wasteful of a police officer's time than that? Probably not. But at the time, understand, please, we were told in our academy classes, it's a felony offense. And felony offenses, by the way, recap, which means the more of those arrests you make, the better the cop you are. I realize how foolish that sounds, largely because it is foolish. But I was of the opinion, as were my fellow officers, that if we can make a lot of these arrests for low-hanging fruit, frankly, we'll get ahead in the organization. If you want to go to detectives, if you want to get promoted to sergeant, lieutenant, captain, if you want to be a police chief someday, get out there and make those arrests.
Internally, we
caused a lot of harm.
On your, at what point did your conscience kick in and say, or your soul, or whatever it is that you have deep inside of you, when you look at what you're doing, when you realize that I'm taking someone who's sitting there smoking essentially parsley that's grown in the field, and I'm arresting this person, I'm putting them in jail for potentially a long period of time. At what point in your career, from 1966 to all the way to 2000, did it dawn on you that, you know, maybe this is a little bit distasteful and maybe I'm going to maybe look the other way? I mean, was it till you retired? Was it like in the mid-70s, 80s, 90s? Was there a moment that you realized, say, you know what, I'm not buying this. I'm not going to put this kid in jail for a long period of time for a felony for smoking parsley.
You know, the short answer to that question is it was about 14 months on the job. In other words, I just by 2 months made my probation as a new cop in San Diego. And I will never forget the moment that I got slapped upside the head by a principal prosecutor who on an entirely different offense, namely drunk in public and unable to care for one's safety or the safety of others, called me on that and said, because I basically acknowledged to him that this 19-year-old kid that I had arrested was not actually drunk, but he had an attitude problem. And I used some choice language to communicate that to the prosecutor, thinking the prosecutor would sympathize and agree with me and acknowledge that we should actually dismiss this case. Anyway, that was in 1967. And it was the sociologists would call it a catalytic marker event in my life. Here's a prosecutor with his three-piece suit and his slick back hair and his tortoiseshell glasses,
Ron,
challenging me in the courthouse in San Diego on an arrest that I had made. He was absolutely right and I was wrong. And the question he asked was, Officer Stamper, does the Constitution of the United States mean anything to you? And my first reaction was,
it's not Trump.
My seconds later was embarrassment. And by the time I slithered down the stairs of the San Diego County Courthouse on a bright, sunshiny San Diego day, I'm awash in shame. It was a mortifying moment in my life.
Why? Why was it mortifying? What was the mortifying part? The fact that he called you to the carpet on the Constitution for defending or for not defending what is a completely egregious abuse of power by trying to arrest someone for cannabis? Is that what was mortifying?
Please understand. At age 21, a brand new cop, I'm telling myself, I'm not going to be the kind of cop that I've seen in my teen years. I'm not going to be an abusive cop. I'm not going to use the N-word. I'm not going to hassle people. I'm going to be a respectable and respectful police officer. That sentiment, once I got sucked into the culture, lasted about 5 minutes. I'm exaggerating, but only slightly.
Wow. All right.
I have a visceral cellular memory of what it was like to abuse the people that I've been hired to protect and serve.
Now, I'm going to ask some indelicate question here, only because that's what I do. It's ask my wife. After 22 months, how many times after that did you arrest someone, if you care to share, for possession of cannabis?
Well, understand that I got promoted probably way too early in my career. I got promoted to sergeant, lieutenant, captain very, very quickly, which took me out of the arresting stage
right.
of my career. On the other hand, my philosophy is, by the way, a philosophy that I hold to this day, and that is don't expect the cops to make law. Police officers exercise enormous discretion in which laws they enforce and how they enforce them, to what degree of, what priorities do they attach to this enforcement. But in point of fact, I think it's wrong for the police to decide, we're going to arrest for this and not for this. We may arrest for that, but not this, so on and so forth.
Well,
I
heard that from Jeff Sessions a couple weeks ago. His job is just to uphold the law, enforce the law. The Congress makes the law, and he just enforces it. That's what he said, right?
He did, but you gotta hear me out till I get to the punchline.
I want to hear you out. That's why you're here.
Okay, the punchline is this. Thinking, rational public servants with a conscience have not only a right, but an obligation to make decisions, discretionary decisions about arrests.
Right.
A quick example. In the city of Seattle, and this is more recent, in 2003, the citizens of Seattle said, We want to make cannabis enforcement, marijuana enforcement, simple possession by adults, the lowest enforcement priority on the books. And so they voted to that effect.
What year was this?
2003.
Okay.
So it's
this is after you've retired. After you've retired.
Oh, yeah. It's three years after I retired.
Okay, good.
But I will also tell you that over the course of my career as a police officer, as an administrator, as a policymaker, as a priority setter, I'm saying nonviolent drug offenses should be our very lowest priority. We can't erase them from the books because we're the cops.
Right.
But we can say we're not going to go after a 19, 20, 23-year-old in possession of a half a baggie of weed. We're just not going to do that.
All right. So you rise up the ranks. You become captain and sergeant and then captain. I remember Hill Street Blues. The sergeant would tell them during the day, listen, this is what you go out and do.
Right.
You cannot, you say you can theoretically direct how things are going to be done. You're going to make things lowest priority. At what point in your administrative career did you enforce or did you encourage, not even encourage, did you let the people who were working beneath you know that in your opinion that the possession, the nonviolent possession of cannabis should be the lowest priority? And follow-up question, did your officers, did your police force, did they follow that?
The answer to your question is in the late 1960s, early 1970s, I began saying that this is absurd. What we are doing is abusing our citizens in the interest of so-called, drug law enforcement. That, by the way, was before Richard Nixon famously proclaimed drug abuse public enemy number one and declared all-out war on his people.
Right.
Meaning predominantly young people, poor people, people of color. And so my position that I stated explicitly in those days was we're going to attach a very low priority to drug enforcement.
So you sent your people out there in the streets like on Hill Street Blues. You said, look, this is the lowest priority possible.
I did not say this is the lowest priority possible. What I said was of all of our.
And it's okay if you didn't. I mean, I'm just trying to figure out the evolution of your process, how you got to the point where you are now.
You're not even paying attention.
And it's a really important line of questioning, because what I want to say to my fellow cops, my former colleagues who are still in the business, you have the right to make discretionary decisions and use that discretion. If you can't wipe a law off the books, and as a police officer, you cannot, then what you can do is to say burglaries and robberies and car prowls and auto thefts and drive-by shootings and home invasion robberies and domestic violence and child abuse and hit and run drivers and those driving under the influence of any substance, including cannabis or booze or any other substance that affects psychomotor skills, is that you can place those priorities so high and straight marijuana or cannabis enforcement so low that those arrests will actually fall by the wayside and you won't be making them.
And looking back,
because throughout the country, with very few exceptions, I'm pleased and proud to say that I worked on the I-502 initiative here in the state of Washington that made both medical and recreational use of marijuana legal for adults, that we're beginning to see more and more states accomplish that. But what we've still got is the majority of the states saying to their law enforcement officers, in the interest of waging the drug war, go after people in possession of marijuana. It's an absurdity.
In looking back, if you could do it all over again, would you take your position as captain in the bully pulpit to do things differently? Would you impart upon the people, the men and women who go out there and risk their lives every day, would you impart upon them your new philosophy of saying, listen, the cannabis stuff is nonsense. Don't even deal with that stuff. We have other things to worry about. I know that you're a police officer. Your job is to uphold the Constitution. These are the laws. But in looking back now, if you had a chance, would you have changed what you had told them and really minimized the effect of cannabis and the pursuit of cannabis and those who use cannabis in the legal sense?
Well, you know, at the risk of sounding defensive, I did do that.
Oh, good.
If what you're asking is, would I have gone from, you know, on a 10 scale, would I have gone from a 7 or 8 to a 10? The answer.
Well, this one goes to 11.
Is proper, or we'll go to 11. We turn it up to 11.
Right.
The answer is probably yes. At the same time, I was also conveying a message to the society, and that is, please do not expect police officers to make law. I think it's vital that citizens understand that through the initiative process, through putting pressure on their legislators, we can, in fact, eradicate these laws from our criminal sanctions, can and must.
Hey, Norm, isn't that...
And we did it in this state.
Didn't it run the gamut, though? Wasn't it? I mean, that's great that that's how your position was on this, but did you have police chiefs across the state and I guess across the country ran the gamut of how they prioritized cannabis? Were some all against it, or was there like sort of a expected thing to let cannabis kind of go down lower scale? How was that?
You know, I do believe that many years ago, many police administrators whispered their support for legalization. They whispered their support for setting the priorities so low that nobody's paying any attention to the enforcement of cannabis. But I honestly believe that as long as you have that low-hanging fruit, you know, the 19 to 20, 23-year-old out there on the streets in possession of a small quantity of cannabis, they would say, as did many of their rank-and-file cops, yeah, but it's a tool. As long as that law's on the books, we can use this
for what?
To justify a search, a seizure, and the addition of other charges.
Now, listen. So, you're in law enforcement. Norm, you were law enforcement. We do a Fakakta television show once
at
a week.
Best.
And we're not even going to give you the top. We're just Fakakta. We do this Fakakta show, and we talk about conspiracy theories and this and that and how the reason why it's important for law enforcement to arrest people smoking cannabis is because they're easy to arrest. And there's some relationship that exists with the prisons and all this stuff, and you'd much rather have these nonviolent cannabis smokers as opposed to going after the crackheads or anything like that. I mean, we talk about these conspiracy theories, but really, we're talking out of our ass. And we don't know anything we're talking about. It sounds good. But what is the relationship between the private prison or the prison population and the reimbursement for prisons and their desire to arrest cannabis, nonviolent cannabis users?
It has been unconscionable.
That's right. You know what? You were right, Ron. Tope was wrong. You were right, Ron.
It has been utterly destructive of public confidence and public trust in the criminal justice system in general, and the police in particular, because it's the cops who are the gatekeepers to the rest of the system. So they're out there making these stop and frisk based arrests. They're sending people to prosecutors. Prosecutors are charging. Convictions are obtained. And then they're going off to private prisons who are making profits, who when they're filling, building and then filling jail cells for profit, they're engaged in what I consider to be one of the most obnoxious and unconscionable practices of public policy imaginable. We are seizing people's property on basic traffic stops. If we have a hint that there's any kind of drug activity or possession of a small quantity of cannabis, for example, what we see in many, many states across this country, people going to jail, or almost worse, not going to jail, but having their assets seized by local law enforcement and forfeited. You know, it's like, what kind of a country are we living in?
Well, didn't this just come up last week with the government, with Trump saying that the search and seizure is unlawful, and he went crazy. Said, no, of course it's lawful. How else are we supposed to control things? I mean, I'm really confused.
It's another level of control.
I mean,
well, here's a guy who, as a candidate, was saying, let's send the feds into Chicago.
Right.
Because of all the carnage right. on the street.
That, well, I'm going to send the feds in.
Is related to the drug war. Let's send the feds in, and let's really boost the practice of stop and frisk. And there's no consideration of the constitutional requirements associated with stopping somebody under suspicious circumstances, reasonably objective suspicious circumstances, and ultimately perhaps making a drug arrest. I think what we've done is created generations of police officers who believe essentially they can stop anybody they want for any reason they want. And if they, as a result of a lawful or an unlawful search and seizure, find and take drugs from somebody, start the criminal proceedings. I think our criminal justice system is in dire straits and much in need of reform, urgent reform.
What is the reform? Because we live in a bubble here. We're in our own little bubble. We're not seeing this, but there's so many people who are living this nightmare. Everybody talks about reform. What is the reform? Everybody says, well, we need more communication. Is that really it? Is it more communication that we need when we see all these community activists, when all the shit's going down in Ferguson, the shit going down in Chicago? Is that the answer? We just need more communication? Is that the answer?
Every time Americans see, and I'll just put this in black and white for a moment.
Okay.
It obviously has all different shades and hues and tints, but let's put it in black and white. Every time the American people see Michael Brown shot and killed on the streets of Ferguson, or hear about it, read about it, observe the aftermath of it. When they see Walter Scott being shot in the back by a police officer in North Charleston, South Carolina.
Well, he's running away.
Juan McDonald being shot in Chicago, or a 12-year-old boy, a lonely 12-year-old being shot on a snow-filled a park in Cleveland. It raises huge questions that didn't used to get raised. And the reason is because we used to just read about that or hear about it from a police spokesperson. Today, we're seeing cell phone and videos. Video.
Yeah, right. Everything's
social media has changed all that. Okay, so please, Norm, where do we start? How do we fix this? Because, I mean, I got a wife. I don't know if you have a wife or not, but I got a wife who, when there's a problem, the first thing she wants to know is,
what did you do wrong?
Who fucked up? Who made this mistake? And my philosophy is, how do we fix this? I don't care who fucked it up. I'm more concerned about how do we what's the next step to fixing this?
So, well, I consider us kindred spirits. I mean, it is vital to understand who's responsible for this bad thing that's happened, and for that person to be held accountable for that bad thing. But we need to go beyond the event or the incident and look at the system that is producing a culture that is giving rise to this behavior. That's hard work, and it's not all that sexy. But in point of fact,
we need
to do three things. One is, we need to end the drug war yesterday. We have made frontline domestic peacekeepers soldiers, foot soldiers in the war against their own people. Number two, we need to set national standards for policing. How good is good enough to wear the uniform and that badge and to strap on a gun and possess, in effect, life and death authority? We don't set national standards for police work at all. We just don't. We do that for the Food and Drug Administration. We do it for agriculture. We do it for barbers. We do it for beauticians. We do it for morticians. What standards really bind police officers to the constitutional guarantees that the citizens they serve are entitled to? And three, we need to put the community back into community policing. And by that, I mean citizens. I use that term not in the context of citizenship, but citizens, as in the context of the citizenry of Ferguson, the citizens of New York, need to be sitting in on the hiring interview for police officers. They need to be teaching in the academy. They need to be sitting shoulder to shoulder with police commanders who are looking at allegations of police misconduct and the investigations into police misconduct. In short, we need a people's police. And no. I don't just offer that up as a rhetorical flourish.
Norm, were you saying that you're
citizens
for...
Citizens should be involved were in you... their policing.
Are you for the legalization of all drugs?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Interesting. Right,
because it's a health problem, not a legal problem.
That's right. Treating it as a health issue versus a criminal issue.
I mean, illicit drugs, let's talk about all drugs, including alcohol, which we know to be the most dangerous and the most damaging and the most costly.
And prescription drugs. Let's not forget about those.
All drugs. That all drugs should be regulated. And they should be controlled. And somebody ought not to be allowed to drive impaired or to furnish to a kid. But at the same time, if we were to look at the health issues associated with all drugs and recognize the public, the value of placing drug policy within the context of the public health arena, and if we were to stop treating sick people as criminals, I'm talking about those who are addicted. Those who are addicted to alcohol.
Right. We know addiction is a health issue. Correct. Yeah.
Put them not behind bars, but into some medical program that has promise, and there are many out there that would allow them to recover. But we, you know, there's something about us where we get crazy, I think, when it comes to drugs.
Well, you know, I know you want the community to judge and have a say in who the police officers are. Let me Harold and Kumar you for a second. I mean, in Harold and Kumar Goes to White Castles, what you learn is the bullies from high school go on to into law enforcement. That's what they do. They bullied you in high school, and they become bullies in the law enforcement.
Is that where we learned that from?
That's where I learned. I really had no idea that's where they came from. I really had no clue.
One of the many important messages we learned from that movie.
Harold and Kumar. Plus, you can't ride a cheetah. But the other, but I guess it's all leading to the question is, I mean, if the police can't police themselves, where do you stand on the body camera issue?
I opposed it originally. I was neutral for 3 or 4 or 5 years as I kind of sorted out my concerns about the privacy rights of citizens, for example, not to be filmed by a police officer on a traffic stop or whatever. And ultimately, several years ago, came to the conclusion that we need to do it, that every police officer in the country needs to be wearing a body.
And that's because
every police officer needs to be wearing one of those cameras.
Can I be cynical? Is that because you've lost faith in the police officers?
I've lost faith in the system of policing. I have worked with and have great fondness for individual police officers who are compassionate, effective. They're really good, tough, effective crime fighters. But they're also dignified and respectful and mature and patient and competent human beings. And those police officers deserve everything we can give them to help make their job safer, easier, and frankly, more satisfying. So it's not individual cops, although I'm a strong believer in individual accountability. It is the system itself that is in desperate need of overhaul.
Now, I would argue that having the body cameras essentially allows the police to police themselves, that they don't, it protects them from absolute power corrupting absolutely, that you essentially, because you know you have this on you, because you know you have this, that you actually have to think, just for, even if it's for a split second, before you do something that may come down, that you have to explain away, where the cover-up is always worse than the crime.
You're aware that you have that camera right there all
the
time.
Right.
You know, one of the fascinating things, I'm a major film freak, and one of the fascinating things that I've learned about people who are subjected to continuous recording, audio, video, or both, is that after a relatively short period of time, you almost forget that it's there.
Truman Show.
So I think there is that phenomenon.
Kardashians.
But I do agree with you. If I know that I've got a camera in the middle of my chest or my glasses or wherever we fix these cameras, if I know that that thing is running during a police-citizen interaction, I'm more likely, I think, than not, to behave myself, to clean up my act, to avoid this language, to avoid that behavior.
Even if it's split second, how much happens in that split second? Even if it's a split second where you realize, oh, wait, there's a camera on me. I can't do this. Even if that's what we all need reminders to be normal. We all need reminders to be moral and to do the right thing. And sometimes things get out of control. So having a reminder like a camera, I'm not sure that's the worst thing in the world.
Yeah, that doesn't bother me because it's on your mind. Yeah, all right.
I'm sorry. I'm in agreement with you. It took me a while to come to this conclusion, but I'm a very strong advocate of body-worn cameras for police officers.
All right, now let's get back to your involvement with LEAP. Now, LEAP is Law Enforcement Against Prohibition. We have had on our show very early on.
Yep.
I'm sure you know Diane Goldstein.
Of course.
All right, Diane was awesome on our show, actually.
You know, she's an ex-Long Beach police. Was it Long Beach or I think it was Long Redondo was Long Beach.
Redondo Beach comes
Redondo
to
Redondo Beach, right. She was an ex-police.
She was so good.
And, and she's very vocal about this. Her brother was severely addicted to, I believe it was heroin, and she watched him devolve and his addiction become a criminal issue, and she watched this happen and she just said, this isn't right. It's not a criminal issue. This is a medical issue. And I get weekly, monthly newsletters from Neil Franklin. I'm sure you know Neil. I mean, he runs the thing. Different police officers get to where you are in LEAP in different ways, but there seems to be a lot of you getting to this point.
One thing I definitely need to say, otherwise Neil will be unhappy with me, so will Diane, and that is Law Enforcement Against Prohibition has kept its acronym but changed its name to Law Enforcement Action Partnership.
I refuse to accept that.
Yeah,
I refuse to accept that because I do like LEAP. But
it's America, and I love that our organization was against prohibition. As am I, as is every other member of the organization. But here's one thing that's happened. We have found ourselves not invited to certain meetings because of our niche, because of our opposition to prohibition.
But
what if we're talking about mass incarceration? What if we're talking about stop and frisk? What if we're stopping? We're talking about a variety of issues that really cry out for police reform.
That
we
group.
Sure. That this organization, which is an extraordinary organization, is invited to the table on any conversation about police reform.
Well, I get that. So they kept the acronym.
Right.
We kept the acronym.
But they changed what the acronym meant.
And we're still.
But aren't you still going in there as LEAP?
Yeah, we're still against prohibition. We are LEAP, and we're still against prohibition, but we are the Law Enforcement Action Partnership, and we are now partnering with everyone who's got a police reform agenda.
It sounds like a group going after the Power Rangers, doesn't it? I mean, against prohibition. I mean, it sounds like you guys are saying, fuck you. We're here.
Even like with Diane, it's like that just adds so much credibility to this cause, though, because now you've got actual law enforcement agents that are giving you the straight dope on this issue. They know they're the front lines. Instead of hearing this nonsense that this is a gateway drug and this causes crime, which none of this is true, you guys know the real truth, and it adds a lot of credibility to the cause, I think. I think it's a very important organization.
I do too.
I thank you for that.
This is our second LEAPer
of the organization. Thank you for that.
Yeah, listen, we're big supporters. It seems like in quantum chemistry, quantum physics, there's a thing called delta H, and what delta H says, or delta G rather, it says that there's a million ways, infinite number of ways to get from point A to point B. And I think that as a physician, as an advocate that Ron is, as a law enforcement officer that you are, you know, we've all gotten to this point through different routes. And it's amazing to see the perspective that one brings to the table to get to this point. And I applaud you for not only the work you've done in serving our society as a police officer, but also the work you're doing now in trying to raise awareness and make people understand that you've been on the front line of making cannabis and drugs a legal issue. And you see, you were there, and you know it's not a legal issue. It's a medical issue. It's a health issue.
Simply because it is.
Yes.
I mean, this is a substance that has been around for as long as we have as humans. And the fact that it was legal up until the early part of the last century.
Right, 12,000 years.
Is an indication of how foolish we have been in prohibiting it.
Craziness, right? It's hard to believe. If you look at the whole scale, it's just like right here.
It's all about money, Ron. It's all about
money. But see,
money.
We grew up
we
with that because
we know that it's
farmer.
About race. We do know
well, that,
that
too, yeah.
No question.
Prohibition is fundamentally about race. We know that the drug war was fundamentally about young people and people of color. I mean, Richard Nixon said it explicitly.
To Ehrlichman, he told him. How do we keep the hippies down? How do we keep the African Americans down?
Negro,
give them drugs.
The Negro and the anti-war hippie, to use Richard Nixon's language.
Hard to believe.
How do we send a message that we're not going to put up with this anymore? That's
arrest them. Arrest them for using drugs. Okay. Look, now Ron's family, long big Nixon supporters. I don't know, especially his brother Robbie in the corner.
I wonder what you were digging for there.
I remember. I remember the stories you told me about Nick. You had the picture of him bowling.
Right. Well, I'm a big fan of that picture. You know, let me just cut to a piece of news here because we usually do news at the end of the show here. Let me just tell you this. I have a quote here. This came out yesterday. West Virginia has introduced a bill in their legislature to legalize cannabis. And here's the quote when they came to the floor. It said, "In the interest of allowing law enforcement to focus on violent crime, property crime, and generating revenue for education and other public purposes like individual freedom, the legislature of the state of West Virginia finds that marijuana should be legal." How do you like that?
I do like that.
Right up your alley, right?
I'm not sure it's going to have any teeth, but
I thought it was great the way they put that. You know, it's exactly what you're saying there, Norm, right?
Well, the fact that they included individual freedom gives me a lot of encouragement.
Yes, I thought that was really well put.
Yeah,
but
now you're in California where we voted back in November to decriminalize because it's still not legal, whatever the term recreational is. And then the mayor of San Bernardino sends a letter to Trump a couple days ago saying that, you know, there's a lot of people using cannabis out here in San Bernardino. Could you please come in and help us clear this nonsense
out? Well, how about this guy? See, now people are trying to do their own little views on this instead of looking at the actual facts. That's why
if we've learned anything over the past 60 days is that facts are meaningless.
Completely meaningless. Sorry.
You say whatever you want. You say whatever you want. I've got a full head of hair.
And if you put it in quotes, then it's even better because then you can say, well, I just put it in quotes.
Well, I got a full head of hair.
Right.
It depends on my definition of hair. In my world, hair is the equivalent of skin.
You're epidermal. Right.
Norm, let me tell you something. We normally fuck up these interviews online because we can never pull it off. It never works out. And, you know,
and you've kept that streak going, so I appreciate that.
Because you're being altogether too modest.
No. We fuck up a lot, man. We're a mess over here, especially Topo. We haven't seen Topo over here. He's got his pants down on his ankles. There's absolutely no reason for that at this particular
again?
Point. You should I know, right?
Right, again.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking
about.
I'm
glad you didn't have to come into the studio to see
No, I want to tell you. Let me tell you something. I want you to come back again because I don't think we've scratched the surface what we can talk to you about.
No.
I mean, you're actually intelligent. You've been on the front line. You actually have an opinion. And it just so coincides that it's the same opinion that Ron and I have, which makes it even easier.
Yeah, but he's got the credibility behind it.
Well, I got credibility. I'm a fucking doctor. What are you talking about?
I'm a captain.
You're a captain. You're a captain of industry.
He's got 34 years in law enforcement. I think that really brings credibility to it.
Listen,
and we really appreciate you speaking out on this.
You spent 34 years in law enforcement. You realize that this war on drugs is complete nonsense, and that the worst thing that happened to us all was Nancy Reagan. I mean, it's just craziness.
After Nixon.
After Nixon. She comes a close second. Yeah. She comes a close second. Norm, what say you on that?
Well, Nixon's the one who originally declared war on his own people.
Right.
And put cops on the front lines of this drug war. You don't fight a war without an enemy. And the enemy turns out to be the American people.
Is that the reason? Is that the reason now, why there's now 17 Richard M. Nixon airports? Oh no, there's none.
Oh.
Well, it's the library's family paid for. Norm, listen, I want to thank you for coming on, man.
It's my pleasure.
You're a treat. You're a hoot.
I would be remiss, and my publisher would be unhappy, if I didn't mention my new book. Which
Please.
Go right ahead. Plug away.
Yeah, I'm plugging away. It's called To Protect and Serve, How to Fix America's Police. And in it, I have 8 agenda items, 3 of which I've cited tonight. End the drug war. Create a true definition of community policing and set national standards for police work. And revoke licenses if police officers can't or won't abide by the Constitution.
Well, look, guys, you guys listen to this show. You've heard Norm firsthand. He's fantastic. Check out his book. I'm sure it's available online. Check it out, Norm Stamper. I'm sure he offers a lot of insight because he's brought a lot of stuff to our show tonight. And
I feel really good right now.
That's right.
I feel really good. Norm, thanks so much, man. I really appreciate you coming down. I'm telling you, we're calling again because there's more I need to talk to you about, and some of it's personal.
That's your business. Maybe you can handle that off the air.
Of it's sexual, but I absolutely want to speak to you again because you're knowledgeable, and I dig your scene, dude. I got to tell you, I'm a big fan.
And we like your style.
I like your style, dude. Playing one against the other.
You're very, very kind. Thank you very much.
Take care, Norm.
Thanks, Norm. Good night, everyone. This was a great show. I really enjoyed having him on, man, right?
How about talking to someone who knows what the hell they're talking about?
Right.
Normally we got Tope, we got Stein, Robbie in the corner. Nobody knows what they're talking about. He doesn't even know his name.
No.
He introduced him as Siegfried. The fuck is Siegfried?
Three guys who have no idea what they're talking about. Then you get a guy like Norm on here, and it's amazing, right?
He's humbling. He humbles me.
Yeah, it's really refreshing.
Because
we
sit here on this stupid fucking show every week, and we pontificate, and we offer what little insight we have. As a physician, I try to give my stuff. As a guy who does aliens, you do your shit. But he was there.
Yeah.
He had the opportunity to essentially direct people not to use cannabis as a racial tool.
It's amazing.
I mean, I was trying to get that from him.
He did, and it was very interesting. And I think people may have stayed for the whole show this time.
No.
Because normally they're gone in the first 10, 15.
I'm not staying for the whole show.
Well, we saw that. I didn't want to mention that here on the air. But it's really nice to hear a firsthand account like that, too, and what it was like 40 years ago or then 30 years ago. It's interesting.
Or 60 years ago when you were born.
Well, in my case, yeah.
Greatest generation.
Sorry. I think we're done here for the day, but it was great having Norm on. Guys,
let's ask a couple of Mike Stein. We got a couple minutes left.
You want to ask Mike Stein something?
A couple questions.
You got a follow-up to Norm? Good luck. Go ahead. What do you got, Mike?
Norm, now, Mike, you have a bar mitzvah picture hanging in your house.
I do.
That he has.
That if you just put a little black shoe polish on your mustache, you'd look identical. What are the chances of you donating that picture to the doctor,
to
the Elevate the Conversation show, so that every week we get a chance to look at you? And you know what, Mike? You don't even have to answer now. You can
stew on this one.
No, I put that in my will. Yeah, you got that one.
You don't have to answer now.
How about the attorney who's got to read that? Well, and left to Mr. D'Ambrosio.
Dr. D'Ambrosio.
Excuse me. One picture of Mike's bar mitzvah.
I actually caught my son taking it out of the wall to bring it over here one day.
I got him. He said to me a couple times, "Listen, what do you give me to grab the picture?" I caught him
taking it off the wall. He wants to.
I need that picture.
The fact that it's on the wall is fantastic.
Now, Topo, I want your quinceanera picture. could you please bring that when you dance with your father to dad, to daddy's little boy?
All right.
You know, after such a good job, 55 minutes of great, well, very, very good, interesting talk. Now you're going to bring it here.
He didn't invite us to his quinceanera.
I'm
that's
hurt.
That's just not right.
Well, it was 10 years ago.
What? Well, the time means nothing. Now, it's 10 years ago, so you're 25. Now, how are you doing with the driving?
Getting close.
You're getting close to what?
No, you said getting that in our August show. You said you're getting close. Where are you now?
Getting close to what? What does that mean, you're getting close?
I need to pay off the wall first.
You have to pay off the wall before you drive a car?
No, why I drove through it.
Listen, that's not going to work. Here, listen, you understand you're a man,
yeah.
Right? You got to do manly things. Driving a car is an extension of your penis. You understand that, right?
Absolutely.
Okay. Well, you know, and driving a Yugo is not really what we're talking about right here. Men drive cars because they have penile. Are you aware of this?
I wasn't aware.
Did someone tell you, what did they teach you in your family when you were growing up? There were other men in your family, right?
Yeah.
Did they not all drive cars?
Yeah.
Well, and so what, when they saw you, said, no. You, no. No, you don't drive the car. Here, we're going to give you the string. Let this hang down. You're good to go.
Oh, gee.
I mean, seriously, what happened? What was, why are you different? Other than the fact that you're different, and I love your difference. I do.
Right, celebrate his differences.
We celebrate every day. Why are you still not driving a car? I'll give you my car to drive. I want you to drive home tonight.
Okay.
All right, you'll drive me home tonight? Sure. Ron, would you sit in the car with him while I drive your car?
We've got to go, folks, on that bombshell. Stay tuned. Maybe next week, Topo will have a driver's license. I don't believe it.
Really?
Maybe. It's a maybe. It's a cliffhanger. This will bring him back next week. And if Norm doesn't bring you back, I don't know what will, because he was fantastic. He was very informative.
How great was that?
He was fantastic, and I really enjoyed hearing the right from the horse's mouth, as they say.
I mean,
he was really so forthright.
I mean, how often do you speak to someone who had a chance to realize, I made these mistakes, and it's because I made these mistakes, this is where I'm at now.
Pardon the pun, but he was
somehow,
very, very frank
the
whole time.
That reminds me of Frank.
He was very frank.
And so am I.
In many ways.
Thanks, everybody. Thank you, Ron. Thank you, Robbie. Thank you, Shlomo Glickstein. And thank you, Miss Quinstonera. And Jarvis,
good night, everyone.
Of course.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Topics and music that affect your life from Universal Broadcasting Network. Tune in at UBNRadio.com.